Are we on the air?
You're now in the mix with The Corner Radio, hosted by Kill. Banging nothing but classic hip-hop, soul, and R&B.
What's good? Y'all tuning into The Corner Radio, hosted by your man Kel. I got my hip hop squad up here in effect with me today. I got my brother Vegas. What's poppin', fam?
What's good, man? Chilling, man. Happy to be here.
Yo, Cass calling for another album, man. I told him you retired. My man hit me like, yo, I'm feeling your all welcome joint, the new joint y'all just did. I said, well, we got to do like a Twitter poll or something to get Vegas to come out of retirement. To do another joint, so you know, maybe niggas start a poll or something. We get you come back, get back into the game, man. The game needs you, man. And now you, why you leaving, man? The game needs you.
I got some joints in the bowl. I don't retire without a plan.
I mean, I know, man, but I need some fresh joints. I want no, you know, cooked up stuff you had back at Morgan. I want that fresh. You know what I mean? God, what word is it, man? It's something in my rhymes. I always digress. Not that digress is a big fucking word or anything, but I never used it until you used it in one of our rhymes. So neither here nor there. But I always say, I'm like, let me digress, you know, and so whatever. Nick, what's going on, fam?
You ready to talk about this music?
DJ Rec, what's going on, fam? For everybody out there, Rec having some camera issues, so just rock with his profile pic right now for a minute. What's going on with you, Rec?
You know what it is, man. Back and forth, traveling all through Texas, man. You know how it is.
Yo, you need to squash that beef with Houston and Dallas since you in the middle of that mix, man. Like,
Look, I'm gonna tell you like this. Today they was banging Pimp C too hard today, so I don't know if that's gonna happen, man. You know, Pimp C was a pioneer for beef, so I don't know if that's gonna happen today.
All right. Ass talking greasy about Ariza's kids and everything, man. You know, so.
A word?
Yeah, you ain't see, like, it was some little scuffle with something like Dallas and Houston had the other day.
So I did like, see that old boy was talking reckless and Ariza met him out back. I did see that.
And called the cops out for that. So I guess that's the thing.
Hey. Have no palace stuff. Hey, stop talking about cats' kids on the court, man.
And they watch.
I don't
want to gossip, but y'all heard about the boy Fisher got Matt Barnes.
Yes, sir. Seen that.
The game done changed, man. I don't know. Scottie Pippen, White Bang, and Future or something. I don't know what the fuck that was. I don't know what's going on. You leaving NBA money for rap money? Like, okay. All right. So let's get into 2016. This is our year in review. Top five albums, more if you got them. Vague. What's good, fam? What's your number five album of all genres for the year 2016
and why? I'm gonna go with what we just talked about, the Tribe Called Quest album. We got it from here. Thank you for your service. You know, obviously, I'm a big Tribe Called Quest fan, but I hated the Love Movement. Probably heard it twice in 16 years. Second time wasn't on purpose, somebody was playing it. But the thing is,
hold tight. Yeah. Was the Love Movement that bad, everybody?
Yes, it was.
For a tribe, it was.
Yes, it was. The Love Movement was two steps backwards.
Yeah, exactly. It felt like they tried to do something that they never did. They never compromised and tried to be like anybody else or be like what was happening in the game. So. The Love Movement kind of felt like, you know, they were trying to adapt to the change in hip hop, and that's not what people want. But this new album, to me, is kind of what I wanted. I didn't want rehashed tribe beats and formulas. I wanted something that felt nostalgic, but was upgraded for 2016. Yes. And one thing I was telling my man, because he's like, yo, Fife is kind of on there everywhere. And I'm like, Fife ain't never been on every record. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I'm saying? Exactly. Like, that's Tribe's history. He's never really been on. I mean, it's convenient for the situation, unfortunately. But, yeah, I liked it a lot, man. From the first time I heard it, it's not too long. Most of the guest appearances work. I don't really care for the joint with Talib. It's nothing to do with him. It's just the one where I start, you know, when you snap out of an album, you like, you start looking at the track list and like, which one is this shit? Right. You know what I'm saying? Like, you ready to skip, you know what I'm saying? But that didn't happen too often. And there's some times when I listen to that. So, you know, that's definitely one of my top of 2016.
All right, y'all. I don't want to beat a dead horse because I know I'm the only person who kind of liked the love. But let's look at Find a Way. That was a banger song, right? Find a Way.
Yeah. Yep.
Yes. Yes.
That's
Find,
how they got
Find a Way is a banger. Yes.
That's how they banger. Got me. Because when I heard that song, I said,
The booty was dope.
Yes.
Step Up with Busta and Redman. That was
bad.
It wasn't bad. It wasn't bad. It was something that it felt like a throwaway. It felt like a throwaway.
Like It Like That. That was dope, right? Like
man, listen to these cool titles, man.
Yo, man. Yeah, like no thought to it. It's like It Like That, the booty.
We should have known they were breaking up when we saw them with the white skirts on and on the back.
Yeah.
All right. Common Ground. That was good. That was dope.
Which one? I think I remember that one. Yeah.
Common Ground.
The beats were kind of basic to me. It was like kind of stripped down.
Yeah, they definitely were stripped down. You done hit the nail on the head with that one.
Yeah, I think that's what, and you could tell the chemistry between Tip and Five just wasn't there at that point.
Now, Four.
Yeah, they weren't even recording at the same time. They was recording one in Atlanta and one in New York. Fife wasn't even in New York to record that album.
All right, Four Mile,
the documentary.
Was banging. Now his name is Muddy Ranks was trash. Give me Noriega.
That's the worst Tribe song ever.
With Noriega.
Well,
yeah.
Forget it. I'm belated. Forget it. All right, obviously person like that. All right, cool. Nick, what's your number five, man?
Number five is David Bowie, Black Star. Did y'all check that out?
No.
No, I didn't even hear it. It was dope.
Okay.
I'm gonna send it to you.
All right.
Yeah. It's kind of like jazz fusion in a way.
Okay.
Like jazz fusion. It's tight. I'm gonna send it to you. Like when before it came out, he said that Kendrick's To Pimp a Butterfly kind of influenced it. Mm-hmm. I know you ain't too crazy about that album, so we'll see what you think about the David Bowie Black Star. That's my number five.
Oh no, I love the Kendrick.
Oh, you like the Kendrick? Somebody listen to the Kendrick. Was it Babies?
Yeah.
It might.
Now, did this come out before or after he died? Like, was this one of those Biggie Life After Death albums, or did it drop when he was still
alive? I'm trying to remember. He either died like a couple of days right before or a couple of days right after he died.
All right. Yeah. Send that joint. I'm gonna check that out. Yeah. All right, Rec. What's your number five, man?
My number five, man, I caught this John on an Apple commercial, man, during the playoffs, NBA playoffs last year. Sna Allegra. That's how I pronounce it. Her name is spelled Sna Allegra. She had a joint on there. The name of the song I found out was called In Your River. Man, I had to Shazam this joint for weeks because I couldn't catch it. Yo, I caught this joint and I was dumbfounded by the fact that I had no idea who this chick is. Come to find out, she's from like Sweden somewhere over in Europe. And everything on this album is like has this orchestra feel, but it's hip hop. It's not like you put on a Beethoven joint and that's what you're listening to. It's straight hip hop, but she's singing. I don't want to say it reminded me of Amy Winehouse, but that's the feel I got. It just didn't remind me of her, but that's the feel I got when the first time my wife got in the truck and was like, yo, you need to hear this. If she came out with a joint with Salaam Remy, yo, Salaam Remy will make her famous. Period, point blank, no questions asked.
Your name is
not like the medication. It's spelled different. It's spelled S-N-O-H. All right, that's her first name. Yeah, that's it right there, Vic. That's it right there. It's a banger. It's probably one of the most slept on albums of the year. Cats probably heard it on the playoffs commercial and just went right past it. But in me, I was like, yo, let me check this joint out. It's about 9-10 songs deep. I'm telling you, if she get a hold of Salaam Remy, it's a wrap. Because Salaam Remy's going to take her and take that vibe and just amplify it. He's not going to change it. He's not going to tweak it. He's just going to amplify it. She's tight. She slept on it and she's tight.
All right, no doubt. That's what's up. That's what's up.
Yeah. It's called Don't Explain. That's the name of it. The album. Don't Explain.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I like that one because I caught wind of that too, and I kind of had it on my Spotify playlist. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, it is dope.
It's dope.
All right. No doubt. I got a check for that. Number five for me. I'm like Vegas. I'm going with Tribes. We got it from here. Everything Vegas just said. From the door they had me with the first joint, just sounded like Vintage Tribe, and I'm just like with Vegas, it didn't really slow down for me until we got to that the joint with Madlib. You know, I just don't like the beat in the beginning when the beat switches and Consequence comes in. Yeah. I kind of like it a little bit better. But yeah, like I'm still waiting for Ev to explain to me why he don't like it. I know a lot of people. I mean, I know a lot of people who really think, and it's not just don't like it. They're like, "Yo, this album is trash."
What?
I know a lot of people. I know, and the most shocking thing is, I know a lot of cats from Queens. You know, Queens niggas love Tribe.
Hell yeah!
I'm lost, as a lot of people I know really don't like this album. I did. You know, I felt like Jerobi came with it. Consequence redeemed himself. You know,
for Consequences did it to me.
So I don't know, you know, what the beef is, but yeah, we got it from here. Was my number five. But to be honest, I wasn't expecting nothing from it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know.
That this joint came in where it came in at. So that's that for me. Veg, what's your number four joint?
Wait, you did everybody?
Yeah.
All right. Because I don't really have an order. I'm just kind of going off of joints I like this year. But I really like Alicia Keys' album. It's called Here. I'm a big fan of Alicia Keys. I wasn't a fan of her last album and was kind of dug the one before that. But I was surprised by this album because it has a heavy hip-hop, you know what I'm saying? From some of the beats to some of the way she approached some of the tracks. And I was just surprised at how, you know, not that I felt like she was going to put out a whack album, but I was just, you know, I didn't have any real expectations based off of the last two. And when I heard this joint, I was just like, man, you know, it's sad because, you know, in a different time, you know, this album would have been all over the radio. And now,
hell yeah,
it's like it came out. And I think it kind of came out around the time that Tribe came out. So, like Common's album, it got kind of buried. But it was dope to me. You know what I'm saying? It's basically new. Alicia Keys, Hair. I think that was one of the dopest R&B albums of 2016.
No doubt. Nick, what you got on?
Number four, YG, West Coast. Album surprised me because I wasn't a fan of the first one because I'm not a fan. I'm not big on DJ Mustard. I'm not big on that sound. This album, he kind of locked in. I don't want to say old school, but it got that West Coast sound we grew up on.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell he improved on his rap. He never gonna be like the dopest rapper, but you can tell he improved. Like he's serious about his craft. So the YG joint, I don't remember what it was called. Get it real quick.
Now hold on. Who is YG? Who's he down with?
He's down with What he's always screaming, something 400. He's not really down with a crew, man. YG is YG. You know what I'm saying? That's just what it is. Like, the dude, he gets the best from, like, Yeah, he gets respect from just pretty much just about anybody that's rhyming. Like, he really does go hard, but I haven't had a chance to listen to this album yet. I'm gonna check it out. But YG is just wild.
The funny thing is, he on Def Jam, and
yeah, he on Def Jam, but don't fuck with him.
Easy, the one kind of put him out there.
Yep. Funny enough, that joined a couple summers ago. It was that, but yo, like, I was playing that too to then boot it when it came out, just because I was in the clubs heavy back then. But I didn't think he was going to come out the way he came out the frame. He's got potential. I might have to check into that album.
All right, no doubt. No problem. Right, what's your next joint for number four?
Yo, my next joint for number four, man, is that Tribe album, man, for all the reasons, you know what I'm saying, you said, Veg said. I'm like you guys. For one, the first thing that hit me was the return of Jarobi. I was excited, man, because I always felt like Jarobi would get the short end of the stick, but nobody really knew his reasons for leaving the group. And then when he came back and just played his lane, wasn't trying to go out there and be Nas or anything, I felt like that was a good thing. I didn't know what to expect either, and I was surprised. For me, sonically, it was great. It didn't sound like the De La album, and I was scared that it was. Being that those guys run in the same circle and, you know, pretty much are through and through. I agree wholeheartedly with Veg. It felt like 17, 18 years didn't pass and they put the album out. It didn't feel that way. It felt like we got exactly what we were supposed to get from Tribe Called Quest in 2016. We didn't get somebody reaching or trying to put a trap album together. Like, we didn't get that. We got what we were supposed to get. And I'm happy with that. Lyrically, I think it was great. Production was perfect. The topics, bar none, if you ask me, the best Tribe album out of all the Tribe albums, because it was relevant to what's exactly happening right now. You could play this album at any given time and it's going to stick to what's going on. It's socially relevant, and Tribe has always been that. So for me, that was perfect. 16 tracks. I still don't know why they did a double disc. But hey, to each his own. But for me, that was the perfect way to end your career as a Tribe Called Quest. It will not get no better. They did the exact what they were supposed to do. They didn't do too much. They didn't do too little. They didn't try to jump outside of their lane, which they never do. But I think it's a classic. I think it's top three Tribe albums. And I'm a Queens nigga, so I'm not gonna tell you that it's whack. It's perfect, man. It's a perfect album for me.
All right, no doubt.
I want to know what Ev's problem is. I truly do, man.
Well, we gonna get into that. Ev is out on the West Coast, so he's 3 hours behind. So I don't know.
Yeah.
But we definitely gonna get that shit popping off.
Mm-hmm.
On my end of things, for my number four, I got Coloring Book Chance the Rapper. You know what I mean? I'm a big Chance the Rapper fan. First found out about the kid. CNN had a joint, a reality show about Chicago. I saw him on like the hip hop episode ad, and he killed it. And I just think like, yo, the whole joint with Coloring Book, you know, I dug the whole thing of talking about God, people getting at me like Chance the Gospel Rap. I'm like, nah, not at all. I just think this is where he at right now. You know what I mean? So I always like folk who make music for where they're at right now. Chance's next album, he may not mention Jesus at all, because that's where he was for this album. He may be somewhere else for the next album. But I know with all the violence going on in Chicago, and I know they love him in the shot. So I just thought, you know, to make an album like this talking about God and everything like that was just dope. And angels watching over me, having kids in the hood of Chicago, being able to sing about that, you know, instead of having to sing about everything else. And I always tell a story how my teenagers would get in my car and be like, yo, Mr. Kill, can we listen to that song about the angels watching over me? Which is huge to me, because my kids don't never want to hear nothing positive. So definitely, you know, got to get a chance. So salute for being able to come out and like that. That's my number four, John. Veg, what you got for your number three, man?
Chance the Rapper, the Coloring Book.
Oh, man. Check this out.
I kind of discovered him when I came back to Strictly Hip Hop, because, you know, I was like fishing for music to add to the rotation, and I came across the Acid Rap joint that he did. And, you know, I was like, you know, dude is dope. So I know there was a lot of anticipation for this mixtape or album or whatever. and I knew Kanye was handling most of it as far as production and, you know, kind of overseeing the project. And I got the chance to listen to it. I think I can't remember where I was, but I know I was at a hotel and I was like in the gym. So, you know, I was doing my, you know, I'm going to put it on, start my workout and just see what's what. And, you know, I'm saying on my podcast, you know, when I do my top five that's coming up, but if I could have stood up and gave him a round of applause for just an album that you can listen to from beginning to end, like an album that made me not think about the workout, not think about anything else, not think about what I'm gonna do. I was just really engrossed in what he was saying and the music, and the fact that, you know, I always used to shit on Christian rappers because I always felt like there was a...
That's how you really feel, man. You used to shit on them, huh?
Yeah. But let me explain. Not because of their subject matter, but because how they could really kill it if they did it in a way that was more of an MC line. Because I've met dudes who are religious and they're rappers, but they really care about the message, but they leave some of the hip hop out. And I'm like, if you could just mesh the two, you could reach people who don't go to church, who don't hear those messages. You know what I'm saying? Because now your music sounds like the music they listen to, but your music is more positive. And I felt like Chance did that. You know, like some of those records, you know, if you ain't paying attention to the lyrics, it sounds like radio records. But, you know, when you hear the lyrics, you're like, wow, he really did what, you know, I always would say, like, on Strictly and all that, like, how Public Enemy songs used to get played in the club, but that was righteous music, that was conscious. But it was knocking so hard that, you know, it was ready for the club. So I applaud Chance the Rapper for doing an album like that. The Grammy nod, even though I don't give a shit about the Grammys. But he deserves all the accolades he's getting because this album is dope, and I think everybody should at least give it a listen. You know, some singing on there, but the difference between his singing and J. Cole's is he has a very unique voice. Yeah. You could tell that he had some form of training in regards to how he should use his voice if he's going to sing, as opposed to J. Cole sound like me in the car and shit. So, interact with a coloring book. Definitely one of the best of 2016.
Nah, and it's funny, B, because I'm with you. I hate Christian rap. I think it's the worst thing. I think it's the worst thing. And I've had cats, you know, who I go to church with, like, kidnap me, sit me in their car, be like, yo, listen to this. I'm like, yo, you hear that beat? Like, yo, come on. Yo, I hear this beat. Like, this is some old whack crap. Well, you hear how he's rhyming or, you know, X, Y, and Z. And I love how Chance flips it throughout the album because it's not all God heavy.
Yeah.
You know, you got mixtape, you got the joint. God, what's the name of the joint? And it's crazy because when I saw Justin Bieber on it, I'm like, come on. You know what I mean? But even that joint is crazy, you know? So, you know, the joint, and then the joint I love the most, which is crazy, is Smoke Break with Future. And I ain't never thinking about life. Come on, man. Look at these names. Justin Bieber, Future.
Yeah.
You know, Smoke Break all day long.
I got to check this out.
Don't let the track miss. It's a little Yaki on there. It's a whole bunch of little people.
Little Yaki.
The album is dope. So I'm with you on that. Nick, what you got for your number three, man?
Number three, I'm gonna go the complete opposite, the flip side of the coin. Y'all got positive. I'm gonna go a little bit negative with my man Schoolboy Q. This cat right here, man, he's as equally talented as Kendrick. He's just not gonna reach as many people because of the content.
Okay.
Like it's like heavy street game banging. Like if this cat came out in the 90s, he would be Lord.
Yeah.
It's not gonna happen for him now, but Schoolboy Q, if you haven't heard the Blank Face LP, check it out.
You know what I need? This is what I need you. You younger than us. I need you to put together a spreadsheet for me of these new fucking MCs, because I get them all confused. So Schoolboy Q is down with Kendrick's crew, but the first dude you named is down with nobody. I need a like a family tree of who's who, because I get all these niggas mixed up.
I got you.
I need a line for me.
Shit, Nick, you ain't but a year younger than me. I got you if you need some help.
Yeah, I'm sitting here like, nigga, didn't you just say Schoolboy Q? But I don't know who any of these new people are. So broken down, BDE crew. Now, Rec, you said somebody last week on a show, and I thought he was down with TDE, but he's not down with
TDE. He is. I said Isaiah Rashad.
Yeah,
he's in here too. I'm gonna talk about him in a minute.
Okay, so he's down with TDE. Yeah, yes, I need a family. Yes. I'm lost. Yes. I don't know who's in the native tongues now.
He likes too.
Yeah. I don't know nobody, man. I need a family tree. Yeah, I need a crew tree. I'm all.
You know what's sad about TDE? Like, Ab Soul was one of my favorites, but like lately, I don't know what happened to him.
He didn't like his.
He got that Puerto Rican cooch. He hurting right now.
Oh. Hold tight.
I like the production, but he like one of them fake deep cats. You know the cats who think they, but they really not.
Like, but hold tight.
When you pay attention to his rhymes.
Hold up. Time out. The first person you named was YG. Second person name was who? Schoolboy Q. Ab Soul and Schoolboy Q ain't the same person.
No.
We got on the TDE subject. He down with TDE. You don't know absolutely. I'm gonna
say. Yo, Kill is confused right now, man.
Right now, I don't know none of these people, man. And then Isaiah Rashad. Yeah, make me a family.
Isaiah Rashad is nice, though.
Yeah, he is.
Isaiah Rashad is nice.
Now, I seen the one video he got, like, he walking around the projects or something. Like, yeah, I know he's
that's
nice.
That's old. That's his EP from 4 years ago. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. I got you.
All
right. Look at his face. Look at Kill face.
All these dudes be sound the same. Like, they all, it all just
Nah, you got to listen, Kill. It's like Woody Harrelson and Wesley Snipes and White Man Can't Jump. Do you hear Jimmy or do you listen to Jimmy? You got to listen, man. You can't just hear him. You gotta listen, dog. I used to be the same way, man.
All right. So Nick, your number three is who?
Schoolboy Q, the blank space LP. Schoolboy Q.
All right. Cool. All right, Rack. Who you got? Cause you're gonna confuse me right now too. I'm sure.
Nah, I'm not. That's my number three. Schoolboy Q, the blank face EP. This is my issue with Schoolboy Q. Yo, he makes me like him more every time he puts something out. When he first came out, I was like, all right, who is this dude? I don't know who he is. I heard the collard green joint, and I was like, okay, what is this? And after that, the first album, I was sold. This dude toured for 18 months. He didn't sit and just let the album bubble. This dude toured the whole time, did another album, which is the Blank Face. Blank Face is tough. Like Nick said, if this was 95, yo, Schoolboy Q would be a legend. That dude is sick. But the problem is, he gangsta as hell. There's no filter with this dude. He will say just about anything that you shouldn't say on wax. He does not care, but he says it in a way lyrically that you'd be like, yo, hold up, let me rewind that. What did he just say? He's one of them cats. He'll hit you on the two and the four, but he says some shit on the one and the three that you got to go back to and catch. He's one of them dudes.
What's the name of this EP? Because I need to.
It's called Blank Face. You gotta listen to it.
Yeah.
These are some of the. Let me get to some of the notes that I wrote down. The album. Just listening to it is based off a straight experience. You can tell that he's been through these things that he's talking about because the way he's talking about it, you can't. This ain't no Martin Scorsese. You can't just make this shit up. This dude's been through half of this shit that he's talking about and probably the other half we just don't know about. Lord Have Mercy, that joint's produced by Swiss. That joint's tough, but it's very short. It's about a minute and 44 seconds. That part, you got to listen to it. That's his radio joint, but that's probably the only joint they said, yo, that we can squeeze out that might work because the album, that's why y'all laughing because y'all know the album is not, it's not made for radio. It's made for heads. He's a hip-hop head. If you listen to his interviews, yo, the dude, he could be sitting here with us. The dude is a hip hop head. He knows his shit. He knows his shit. Groovy Tony and Eddie Kane, Jada murders that joint. Period. Point blank. I told you. The dude is a hip hop aficionado. He knows his shit. There is no sophomore jinx on this album. Period. I wrote also, he's pushing for his own lane because, yeah, he's just as good as Kendrick, but like Nick said, he's not gonna reach the same amount of fans only because of who he is and what he's talking about and how he's talking about it. He has the potential to do so, but cats gotta sit down and really listen. And can they market him that way? I don't think he wants to be marketed that way because the dude come to your interview with a straight hoodie on. Like, he's just not that dude. I'm telling you, man, check TDE is tough, man. They stay low-key. They stay low-key. Schoolboy Q, blank face. Yes.
All right. For my number three, John, I'm kind of stuck, man. This was a good year.
It was.
Yeah, and I'm stuck. I guess I would have to go for my third joint, Anderson .Paak, Malibu. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I love everything about the album. I just thought, from the second I heard .Paak on Compton, I was just like, yo, who's this? Like, me, he was the star of the show. Like, I know a lot of people, with every album, we'd get introduced to somebody new through Dre, and I think everybody was looking for the new MC, whereas for me, like, we got put down with Snoop through the Chronic and, every DOC. I felt like .Paak was the star of that album. Everybody was looking for the next MC, but
he was.
I felt like .Paak just, he was the one who blew me away, and it was like, yo, who's this? Like, I can't wait to hear who this dude. And it's funny because he reminds me a little bit of a loud. And Bilal used to be down with Dre. And to me, Bilal was such a heavy part of Kendrick's The Pimp a Butterfly. I felt like he played a huge part in that album. So Malibu, oh God, I can't talk about how dope this album is. I mean, this everything is just the writing, the rapping. He's one of those dudes who can go from singing to rapping flawlessly. Like, you don't even realize what he's got. Before you kind of knew he was doing like this chick singing a whole album. With .Paak, I don't even remember. We ain't even know what to call it, Nick. We like, is it hip hop? Is it R&B? I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
He covers everything on it. Mm-hmm. So that would be my third joint. The .Paak joint. And I think even more so because he got down with Dre and I didn't know what part that was gonna play in it. You know what I mean? I didn't know if he was gonna sit for 50 years or if he, when you sign to Dre, it's not like you usually ever come out. So for him to actually come out was dope, real dope to me. So that's my number three. Man, number two, man.
My number two is actually a mixtape. It's Royce da 5'9"'s Trust the Shooter.
Yeah.
I like that mixtape so much, I can't even listen to the album he put out afterwards. Mm-hmm. Because I've kind of always been a fan of Royce, but not a big enough fan to like buy his albums because, he always came across as the battle rapper type. Even though he could write songs, he always kind of approached the tracks in the same way. And once he got sober, that's when we got Prime and we got a couple of other joints. You saw a different Royce, a little bit more controlled, still attacking on beats. But on this Trust the Shooter joint, yo, I wasn't ready, man. Like, you talk about rewind. Like, he's a dude where first couple of bars, you like, hold up. He said this, that, you know what I'm saying? Like, and I was loving that. And, a couple of tracks on there I like the title track, Trust the Shooter. I love rap on steroids. Like, I hate the fact that they tease Eminem because that's an Eminem beat right there. But Royce spazzes on that record. Like, and he know he's spazzing. That's when you know somebody's nice. When they sound like they know this shit is good.
Right.
While they're saying it. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And the other track, which actually made the album, called Tabernacle, where he talk about his history and he talking about his son being born in the same hospital, his grandmother's dying at the same time. He got a show that he got to do. He go do the show. He come back. His son here. His grandma's gone. I thought that was just dope the way he laid that whole thing out. The beats are hot on here. And the shit was free. You know what I'm saying? Like, the type of this type of shit, we would have to pay for, like, $15 back in the days. But you could go to, like, that Piff, anything, and pick that joint up.
I'm going now.
And it was just one of those mixtapes that I always say on my podcast, like, you know, I think they make these shits for us. And then when they put out the album, they try to reach everybody else. But yeah.
And you know what, Rod? You know what? That's fine with me. Like, that's fine. Like, I love it. Like, I always said that. Like, I felt like that's what Fab does. Like, Fab is going to give us joint mixtapes, and then you can do whatever the hell you want.
Exactly.
So, you know, we can do whatever you want with the album, but yeah.
Yeah, man. Royce the 5'9", Trust the Shooter, mixtape, dope for 2016.
Yo, what's your favorite joint on there?
Who, me? Probably Rap on Steroids, because I'm telling you, man, when I'm in the gym, I don't need to be lifting weights with that shit on. Fuck around and pull something. You know what I'm saying? Start believing that shit. You know what I'm saying? But I just love it, because it's just, you know what I'm saying? It's just dudes just rhyming, but on a next level with their bars. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But yeah, man, Rap on Steroids, that's my favorite joint.
Yeah, that joint is one of my honorable mentions. Like I said, this was a tough year. Like I said, I could have done a top 10 easy, but the top five, that would have definitely cracked my top 10, because the joint, Which Is Cool, produced by Knots. Oh my God.
Yeah.
That thing is crazy. My favorite joint on there probably is Wait, the one that Jake One did.
Oh, yeah.
That's crazy. Savages is just stupid.
Yeah, Savages. I mean, yeah.
God, the tempo of that. And then he says something about life and Belly, and he's like trying to put a life in Terrell. He says something crazy that was just, like you said, just rewind factor all day long.
Yeah.
Even the joint Dead President says. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, that joint was crazy. And the bonus joint, Digest, with the chick Tierra.
Yeah,
it was actually true. Like, yeah, and then the crazy thing is, I'm with you. Like, after, I really didn't like Layers as much as this joint.
Yeah, man.
You know, crazy, because not to the joint on Layers that I didn't like at all. Mm-hmm. But then the joint you do on the mixtape is bonkers. Yeah. You know what I mean? So
exactly.
I was confused. Like, yo, how you get the bonker joint for the mixtape and get the joint for the album?
Yeah.
Trust the Shooter was crazy. Nick, what's your number two joint, man?
My number two was your number three, the Anderson .Paak.
Okay.
Mm. Yes, and also, if you're a fan of his, check that album out.
Yeah, man.
There's no worries.
That joint is hot.
With that West Coast cat named Knowledge doing the beats. So, you know, just a kind of a companion piece. Different vibe from .Paak. Anderson .Paak, though, the Malibu. Even you know, he had Knife Wonder on there, Madlib. It just meshed with his sound, because he produced a lot of his own stuff. The brother talented, man. He had this, like you said, he had to stand out on Compton. That was his track. You know what I'm saying? And Drake took it and put it on his.
The funny thing that you named Madlib and Knife Wonder, because most folk know by now, I'm not the biggest Knife Wonder or Madlib fan. But yo, both of them dudes killed their stuff on this album.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? Exactly. Both of them dudes. So like, Yeah. So that's when it was like, damn, you know this nigga good. If and again, before people start with the Twitter and the inboxing, I don't hate them niggas. They cool. I'm not the biggest fan. Because I know in 2016, if you ain't swallowing a nigga, then it's like, oh, you don't like him. You know? No, it's just, I'm not the biggest Madlib fan in the world. He's a good producer, but I don't hold him to the... He's not on my Mount Rushmore like the way he is for a lot of people. So that's all. I think they got good beats, but they're just not my favorite folk in the world. That's all, you know? But yeah, Nick, dope, very dope album. Rack, what's your number two, man?
Yo, if you can see me, my mouth is like wide open. Pause. What's your issue? What is your issue with Knife and Madlib? I gotta ask, even though you put a disclaimer. So
we gonna get this in real quick, man. Everything was always about expectations. So when everybody was blowing me up about Little Brother, oh my God, they're the greatest thing. So tribe. Oh okay. My God.
All right. So this dates back to Little Brother.
Yeah, but and then I heard it and I was like, yo, it's cool, but I don't see what is so incredible that Primo is inviting him to headquarters, Pete is inviting him to the headquarters, all this stuff is going on. It's cool. You know what I mean? And the thing with Knife is I've heard Knife stuff. And see, I guess it's me being a producer. I've never heard a track from Knife Wonder that has pushed me. And what I mean by that is I'll hear stuff by Alchemist and I'll be like, yo, I gotta go make a beat. Like that shit was just
No doubt. Definitely.
So with Knife has never fucked up my head in a way to where I'm like, yo, how did he do that? Like with Alchemist or Jake One, or there are lots of producers who I could be like, yo, how did he do that? You know, with Knife, I don't get that. So when people put Knife up there with Dilla and Primo and them, I'm like, well, just slow down.
Well, you didn't say that. I ain't say that now.
Just slow. And with Madlib, it kind of was the same thing. Way back when, what was the name of his crew? When he first got into it.
Lupac.
He was with the Alcoholics.
Lupac. Nah, he was with the Lupac. That was his crew, the Lupac. When they was on, that's how they got on Peanut Butter Wolf.
Right. So when I used to be up at 88.9, like Titan and all the DJs would play Lupac, and I'd be like, yo, this is dope. And then like my man just kept talking about Madlib like over and over and over again. And I kind of was like, yo, it's dope. But then keep in mind at that same point for me, everything Jay Dilla was coming out. So for every Lupac song I heard a Slum song, which to me was 100 times better than a Lupac. So it's also about that time and thing. You know what it almost is? It's like James Harden and Russell Westbrook right now. You know what I'm saying? Russell Westbrook is just amazing everybody. But James Harden is putting in work too.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? But if you try to ask my vote for MVP, it's going to go to Russell Westbrook right now.
Russell Westbrook so all day.
The Lupac album is dope. It's not no diss on them. But again, it's just like, you know, it's sad to say the same thing when James Harden lost to Steph Curry. What was that, 2 years ago? I'm saying for the MVP joint, like they was neck and neck.
Yes.
Just so happened that Steph won. And it, you know, it's almost like with Knicks fans. It's like, yo, if Jordan didn't exist, the Knicks would have won a chip. If not, a couple of chips. You know, it's the timing of it. So the timing of Madlib with Jay Dilla at the same time was just like, I couldn't keep up. So that's kind of it. But again, not that I don't like them. I think they got dope beats. You know, Madlib is incredible. I couldn't get with the Helium dude that he became, his alter ego. But
Whoa, you couldn't get with Lord Quaz?
I couldn't get with that. You know, I can't. I'm not good with the alter ego shit. Like, I'm old. Like, who are you? If you Slick Rick, then be Slick Rick. I don't need you.
I'm old.
How you decide you want to be Ricky D and Tom Piff? No, just be who you are and just... You know, but that's my little right there. But who's your number two, man?
Okay. All right. So my number two, man, is Isaiah Rashad, the Suns Tyree. You know, this dude took like four, damn near 5 years to come out with this album, man. And I'm glad he took his time. He was going through some shit. Dude had some substance issues. He took his time, got that stuff straight, man. And the album is, it's a great album, but it's going to be a slept on album. Cat's not going to hear this album for the next 2-3 years. Then after they hear it, they're going to be like, oh shit, this dude did come out with an album. It's one of them albums. 17 tracks. The dude is a cross between boom bap and I don't want to say this new age shit, but just like, he's one of them kids that was born probably in like 95, 96, 97 and was fed like the true shit, but ended up growing up hearing that dumb shit and grew up confused. That's the best analogy I can give for him. Cause yo, one track, this dude will hit you with some shit, but then he might talk about bitches and hoes way too much. But he got to a point to where he killed all that and just focused on straight rhyming. And this album is that. He has some good, you know, some good issues with the other cats. He's got SZA on there, Kendrick's on there, J-Rock's on there. It's not a bad album. I've been banging it pretty much since it came out.
For all these TDE cats, who does the beats? Do the in-house producers?
They have about, honestly, they got about 10 different dudes that they just fuck with. DJ Dahi, DJ Khalil.
Yeah.
They got in-house team. And I liken it almost to like 50 Cent and G-Unit. If your shit is tight, they fuck with you. They give a fuck about a name. If you got the shit they fucking with and that vibe is what they on for that minute, yo, you gonna get a placement, period. That's just how they roll. And it's a bunch of just young cats whose moms and dads are hip hop heads like us and said, hey, you gonna listen to this shit. And the next thing you knew, these little motherfuckers was spitting out bangers. Like, it's got a trap feel only from the hi-hats, but yo, these cats are diggers. They've been on the Russian roulette, like, or the rhythm roulette, like they dig. They're not gonna sit there and let the machine do the work. They dig, they make beats. They don't let the beat make them. They make beats, like for real. These cats take they take it seriously. They don't play. When it comes to like crafting something, yo, they really sit down and craft their shit. They are students. That's the only crop of cats, young kids that I've seen who take the production as seriously as the artist takes the rhymes. That's why it sounds the way it sounds. That's why it sounds the way it sounds, because they're not in there bullshit. They ain't no for play. They real with it.
All right, and you tell this
TDE, Isaiah Rashad. He has an EP that came out around 2011, maybe 2012. I do not remember the name. It escapes me. All you gotta do is just Google. There you go.
Yeah.
There you go. Just if you need it, let me know. Shoot, I'll email it to you. Yo, that was retarded. That was retarded. Point blank, the video you saw from the projects. Yeah, exactly. He has been able to stay relevant because of South by Southwest. Every year, them cats is in Austin. Every year, killing Austin. That video you saw with him in the projects, that's that video. It's to that song from that EP. The dude is nice, man. He just gets stuck on because everybody looks at Kendrick and says, all right, this is all we need to know. And that's not what TDE is. TDE has like five artists that can all hold their own, but they just they get overshadowed by Kendrick. It's a great album, man. Check it out.
All right, I'm going to get into it. My number two,
you like it,
is Awaken My Love, Childish Gambino. I love the album. I can listen to this album all the time. It's one of the few albums I actually keep. The copy of the CD that I brought in the whip with me. You know, I got music on my hard drive in the whip, but it's like I see you, Nick. I see you. But I love, when I talk about love an album, I love it, man. You know, I mean, I love the funk aspect of it. I just think, dude, I mean, I said it in a review of the album. It's like, yo, he's not in a zone. He is the zone. Like, everything this dude is touching right now, from the TV show Atlanta to the music, just everything that this dude is doing is just flat out amazing to me. You know, now, again, me and Nick talked about it. I know some people may not like it just off the strength of, well, he's doing funk. If I want to listen to funk, I can go to George Clinton. Totally get that. You know, I could totally get cast and I feel on the album. Maybe they want to hear him rap and he started singing. I get that. And maybe you don't like funk. Those are the three reasons to me why you may not like this album. Outside of that, yo, I could listen to Redbone, and I've done it. I've listened to Redbone on repeat for hours. Like, I love that song, man. So, that Childish Gambino, I love it, man. I love it. And it's one of the few albums that came out at the latter end of 2016 that was still good money for me. You know what I mean? That just in a month of being able to spin it, just won me over that much for it to rank up at number two for me. So, Veg, what's your number one, B?
My number one is Anderson .Paak's Malibu, man. Like y'all said, man, I played that album even to this day, like all year round, man. And you know you really like something when every month or so, you go through like, nah, that's my favorite song. Nah, that one's my favorite now. Now I got this one on repeat. You know what I'm saying? Like the from the first time I heard it, The Bird, you know what I'm saying? When it came on and I was like, oh, this ain't what he did on Compton. This is some other shit. This is a deeper experience. And from track after track, I'm not the biggest fan of him as a rapper. I think he's decent, but I think it works for what he does. You know what I'm saying? It works for him. Because on Compton, I think I really only liked him on one of the tracks. And then there was another one that I wasn't really feeling. So I was kind of surprised when I heard Malibu because, I had to do some research because I actually was supposed to produce a feature on it. At the station where I worked at. Damn, I'm telling the future.
Okay.
Fired already.
Like, damn, I got fired already.
Yeah, that's all.
But nah, you know, I was, you know, did some research on him and I didn't know he got up with Flying Lotus and you could hear some of that. I didn't know this dude play instruments like that. And I was like, wow, he's not just a rapper, he's not just a singer. You know what I'm saying? This nigga's an artist.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And it's dope that he's starting to get those accolades. The album actually came out right before they announced him being on Aftermath.
Yeah.
So I don't think Dre got to really touch it the way he probably will on the next one. But it was perfect. I can see why Dre signed him. You probably heard this shit and was like, nah. I need that. You know what I'm saying?
Another thing too, man. I don't know if you heard of his other joints. He's had a joint Venus. He's had EP and other stuff out.
Yeah.
Venus is out too.
You know what? I sent it to you.
Yeah. It's one of them joints where, you know, you come into artist career and you know you think it's their debut, and you don't know that they had an album or EP or some other work.
Right.
Like the NX joint, you know, I was on top of that when it came out. And it was just dope, man. This album basically introduced me to the brother on all levels. And, you know, I think it was the best of 2016. And I think it should definitely get the Grammy nod that it's getting as far as the win goes. But, you know, politics and shit like that might fall into that. So,
all
right. Yeah, man, some pot.
Nick, what's your number one?
Well,
Ev,
tell Ev to call in.
That should be more, man. You and Ev, I can't wait for this show, man.
Me neither.
We're going to have one. The only reason they not my favorite group is because Outkast is the hometown hero, so it's like 1A, 1B. Everything you guys already said, some of Tip's best rapping on the Tribe album. The production he showed, he's still not rusty, ain't no rust on him. He produced the whole album by himself for the most part. The features work, you know what I mean? I would honestly like to see, with Vice passing, I would like to see Busta Rhymes, definitely, even Consequence, become a Tribe Called Quest. Family, like the Tribe is a group of people. I would like to see that. Because all of their contributions worked on that album to me.
Yeah, I'm a dead dog's lie. just let that die. If Busta and Tip and Quince want to form a group, Busta Tip Quince, you know, that's...
Don't use the Tribe name. I got you.
Yeah. I'm like, nah, we gonna leave that over there, you know. I'm not a fan of them super group. You know, Common and Most Def and Tip are supposed to start a group and... You know, Pusha T, Ricky Bobby was gonna start a group, and so yeah. I'm ass on that, but nah, I feel you. I mean, like you said, all the features worked, and it all just felt good. You know what I mean? And again, the thing that got me excited probably the most for the album was reading the article. I think it was in the New York Times, just of how Fife came out and recorded with Tip, and they kind of squashed their beat, started getting the brotherhood back together. That's what got me hype about this album, because I'm like, okay, boom, you know, all those things that I felt hindered the Love Movement and Beats Rhymes in Life are no longer there. So exactly. We should get...
And then Jarobi, because I had never heard Jarobi rap prior to this album.
Word? I heard Jerobi rap.
Nah, Jerobi was on remixes, man. Early remixes. You got to go back and grab them. They did an early remix album right after People's Instinctive drop, man. I got it if y'all need it. I'll drop it in the Dropbox or something like that, man. But
oh yeah, yeah, do that. Yeah, cause that was my first time hearing him, so I was like, I didn't know what he sounded like. He did his damn thing. Jedi, he did his thing.
No first album, dope number one album. Rack, what you got for your first album for the number one of the year?
All right, man. So I don't know if y'all heard this one, man. Apollo Brown and Sky Zoo, The Easy Truth.
Yeah.
This joint caught me off guard because I didn't even know these cats was doing anything. I didn't even know they was working together. And I don't know if you know much about Sky Zoo, but Sky Zoo been doing a lot of work with Illmind. And Illmind kind of is going to the left a little bit. Yo, Sky Zoo picked up right where he left off with Illmind with this. It's perfect. It almost feel like he wasted his time with Illmind. I don't want to say that, but that's kind of what I feel like with this album, hearing it. It just, it works. And I'm like, how come they didn't do more work together earlier? It's 17 joints, and there's a few features, but the good thing about the features is that's all they are. They're just features. Those cats do not overshadow what Apollo or Sky Zoo do on the album. They're just features. It's just cats said, hey, they was like, yo, you in the studio today? Yo, let's go do a joint. Like, it just works. It does not overshadow what the album is. The standout joints that I picked out was One and the Same, Jordans in a Gold Chain, Stretch and Bob Show has an ill flip of Flavor of the Month. They took the original sample and threw Funky Presidents over top of it. And Sky Zoo goes bonkers, man. It's crazy listening to it because you really feel like this cat is like 92 on Stretch and Bobito Show. You just get that feeling. They got another joint called They Parked the Bentley on the Corner. His Sky Zoo, man, his stories to me have always been great. I've always felt as though he has been overrated because just nobody knows who he is. But his stories, man, if you listen to this cat, yo, the dude's stories, I'm not going to put him in the same category as I'll put a Jay-Z or a Big, but yo, you know the dude is from Brooklyn. That's all I'm going to say. You know the dude's from Brooklyn, and you know that he's inspired by them two dudes just listening to his stories and how he's able to paint those pictures. Because if you close your eyes and you listen to it, yo, you feel like you standing right with the dude. It's a great album. The Flyest Essence, Sick, Care Package, another banger. Yo, to me, Skazoo's been around, what, maybe like 10 years? This is his best album.
Roughly, yeah.
This is his best album. If I had to put it up against any other Sky Zoo album, whether it was Ninth Wonder produced, Illmind produced, Knots produced, whoever that he's ever worked with in his 10 years, this is his best album.
All right. No doubt. My number one joint is this dude Gallant. A lot of people may not have heard of him. The name of the album is Ology. Just incredible, man. Like, I love this album, man. Like, yo, incredible songwriting. The production is incredible. Dude has this crazy falsetto. If cats have never heard of him,
yeah.
My intro to him, my man Chris sent me. Just go to YouTube and put Gallant, Seal, Weight in Gold, and see both of them killing this song, man. It's an incredible album. And I know most people haven't heard of it because whenever I talk to people about it in the barbershop or wherever, they like, word, you know. But Gallant, Ology, incredible album. Real quick, I want to still dive into some of the stuff that happened in 2016, but a couple of honorable mentions I got. Salon Just Seat at the Table, an incredible album. Yeah. Cats may be mad at me, man, but yo, Beyonce's Lemonade, man. I love that album, man. But, you know, I ain't gonna get shocked at it, but yo, it's a dope album to me. Blind by Frank Ocean, another dope album. Tigalero, Fonte and Eric Robeson was a dope album. BJ the Chicago Kid, In My Mind, crazy album. And then on the hip-hop side, I like Pablo. I know a lot of people didn't like it. I rocked with Pablo. Rage in the Machine, Joe Button, in the Silent Partner with Havoc and Alchemist. That to me was a banging album. Big, you got any other honorable mention joints?
I got too many, to be honest. I like the Sky Zoo and Apollo Brown joint a lot. I like Game's album, 1992. And it's kind of like a concept album, and they repurposed a lot of that early 90s DJ Quick, you know, Ice-T Colors beats, you know what I'm saying? It's really like him having this concept and going back in time and telling his story, talk about gang culture around that time in 1992, shit, OJ. It's pretty dope. What else? I really like the Khaled album, and I don't like Khaled at all. I've never really liked any of his shit because it always felt like he was, you know, I'm not gonna hate on him for making radio records, but it always felt like but I felt like it was very well balanced between older generations and new generations. Nobody sound out of place on tracks. Like, you know, I mean, I'm pretty sure y'all heard the Nas track. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
The J. Cole joint is hot. Like, I really liked it. I know y'all heard the Drake shit because it's all over the radio. But I like the Khaled album, Major Key. I wanted to say this joint because I was going to put in my top five, but Music Soul Child's album, that came out this year?
Whoa, what?
That was this year, right?
Oh, you don't push one of the kill buttons.
Oh, wow. That album was good?
Yo, you didn't hear the album, Kim?
I don't care if he's from Philly. People be like, yo, how y'all like music? He from Philly. We got to stop this just because somebody's from your city. You got to love him. Like, yo, man, you don't like, what's the dude who be jumping around everywhere, Panda? Like you don't like dude, he from Brooklyn. Like, okay, he from Brooklyn, but it was good. It was a good album.
Yeah, yo, like the album cover is trash. Because when I saw the album cover, I was like, oh, this is probably some garbage. Then when I saw the title, the title of the shit is Life on Earth. The album cover ain't got shit to do with Life on Earth, as far as I can see. Nah, that's Music Soul Child. But no bullshit. That fucking album is hot. Every record.
I know the dude who's married to Mary Mary. One of them. I think he did all the productions. I think he signed to his label now.
He blessed him because I like with Music Soul Child and me. I love one album and then I think the next one is completely garbage. Right. And it'll take a minute before he comes out with a on my radio where I'm like, oh, this shit is hot. And then he come out with the shit where he was trying to rap. Yeah. But, you know, I decided, I was like, well, let me see what this sound like, regardless of the cover and the album title. And I was like, damn, this shit is hot. But nobody heard it. You know what I'm saying? But I think that was a dope album, too.
I'm going to have to check that. Nick, you got any honorable mention joints?
You ain't even like Music Soul Child when he was with A Touch of Jazz?
I mean, I did, but keep in mind, man, it was one of those, what I heard, what's that song? And I like the song. I love the song. What was his first single?
Just Friends.
Just Friends. Love the song, but it just had such a heavy D'Angelo vibe to it that I just kind of felt like it was the bite of D'Angelo. You know what I'm saying? But I mean, there's songs that I like. I just don't, you know, I don't like, people love music. My next door neighbor was like, music is my favorite neo-soul artist. And I'm just like, have you not heard of D'Angelo or Maxwell? And like, you pick me. People really love this dude, you know? And I'm confused as to why, you know? But I mean, I liked him in the Touch of Jazz days because I felt like the production helped carry him along the way, which is why I like the dude who's married to Mary Mary or whatever her name is. I like his beats, so I could believe that, you know, it's a solid album.
Well, hearing you say that, that's exactly what's happening with this album because I was a little shocked by how powerful the shit sound. And, you know, it just wasn't, nobody was paying attention to it. Like maybe my wife, because she was the only one. I was like, yo, you heard this shit? And she looking like, is that a pair of jeans and shit on the cover? Like, what the fuck is
that? Yo, it's funny because I almost feel like, didn't John Legend just come out with an album? And it's like, does anybody even care about that?
Yeah, nobody does.
Like, John Legend just used to be the man, and now it's like, I'm like, damn, did he just drop an album like last week and just don't know why he care already? But
that new album is not good.
Yeah, I can't call it. Nick, what's some of your joints, man?
So honorable mentions, like you said, Gallant.
Yeah.
Dope album, that's one. And of course, Solange, Seat at the Table, Raphael Sadiq.
Mm-hmm.
Another one that was mentioned.
Yeah.
South Got Something to Say. That's the Childish Gambino.
Yo, he's from Atlanta?
But he from Stone Mountain, so he like the suburbs. But it's like about 20 minutes.
No, I get it. I used to live in Decatur, bro. I get it. I know all about Stone
Mountain. This is a chick named Jenny. I don't even know how to pronounce the last name. It's Haval. But it's like she exactly. She like a more is hard in my opinion.
All right. No doubt. Rec, you got any quick honorable mentions, man? All right, I don't think Rec there. So, yo, real quick, running down. Yo, Vague, you are like the hip-hop reporter. You are who I go to for any news because I don't know how you keep up with all this shit, man. Like, married with two kids and a job. Like, I have no idea how you find the time to be able to do your podcast, to keep up on everything. What are some of the things that stuck out for you in 2016? Hip-hop, R&B, music-wise. What's some of the good, some of the bad?
I think I got all bad, man, so I'm going to just run through them.
We just talked about how it was a great year for music.
Yeah, we talked about the good music, but we're going to
talk about that. Oh, okay, so that was it. That was the good.
Yeah,
okay.
Talk about that bad shit.
All right, so what's the bad?
Well, one being Afrika Bambaataa.
Oh, yeah.
And that whole situation. Mm. It can't be.
It's hard not
to be 20 dudes saying you molested him, man.
it's funny, man, because I used to, you know, me and my friends are able. We got tough skin, so you know, I mess with some of my friends who are Catholic, and I'd be like, man, I ain't coming to your church, man. It hurt to go. Shoot back, like, oh, I want to be part of your culture, man, because your culture hurt, you know. So,
because you know what's crazy about that whole situation is like one dude was like, they just trying to do this. And I'm like, yo, Afrika Bambaataa ain't got no money. This ain't a Michael Jackson situation. This ain't a Bill Cosby situation.
Right.
Where you could at least question it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And what's dude going to admit that?
Exactly. Like, you could tell there's clearly nothing they want to gain. And the dude who really blew it up, isn't he like a councilman in NY? You know what I'm saying? I wrote a book. Who used to be down with them. So it got to the point, man, where it was just too many stories. And the Zulu Nation wrote a terrible press release. Like, them niggas wrote a press release in their life. And then they just kicked his ass out. Then they just said, fuck it. They just kicked this nigga out. So,
and then the guy who was wild with KRS was talking about, dude. It got even worse.
Because KRS didn't help at all.
Not at all, man. Like, KRS is like, hey, he invented hip hop. Who cares what he did?
That shit was bad. Another joint that was bad, and you know, of course, that shit made me sad to hear about the whole Afrika Bambaataa situation. Was watching Beanie Sigel in a white hoodie get punched in the fucking head backstage. Like, that shit was like, damn. Our era is over. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that shit is over because I'm like, this nigga got a white hoodie on. Like, why you got a white hoodie on? And then niggas just punched you out of, like, you didn't even see the dude's whole body. You just saw his fist and arm. And I'm like, God damn.
Yo, you know what that was like, man? When niggas sent me that joint, it felt like Fonzie getting beat up on Happy Days. It's like, day. Like, how can Fonzie... How the hell can Fonzie get beat up? If Fonzie gets beat up, then what after this? Like, who's gonna protect Ralph and Chachi and everybody? Fonzie gets beat up, like, so I feel you.
It was sad, you know, because I usually try to ignore half of that beef shit because it gets all blowing up and then it simmers down and it's almost forgettable. But you know, like when Beanie was on Tax Stone's podcast, you know, I was like, damn, I gotta listen. And when he was talking, man, it was like Beanie went from being 40 to like 90 to me. Because you know, because of his situation, he sound different. Then he put out those whack ass diss records. I was just like, oh shit, like, you know, our era is over, man. Like that shit is niggas getting punched in the head, no help.
But I will give Beans props. He did get up and still go perform. You know,
wait, what?
Gotta get that money, man.
And the worst part was he got docked out in Philly. Like it was like, that's almost like it was this dude when I was in ninth grade. I was a freshman at high school, and my man Jerome, who was like a senior, he was like the man. This dude, like, yo, he was like, it was like Avon on the wire when he was in jail. Like, you know, people playing baseball, roll walk up, like everybody stop. And yo, he fought this nigga named Jermaine, and Jermaine stomped his ass out. And I just, yo, it was like everything in us just died that day, man. Yo, how did you lose a fight, man? Like, yo, you the dude who could walk around with your gold chains out, nobody, you ain't never tucked nothing. And it was like, man, this, like you said, our era is over. And that's what it felt like. It felt like, damn, you know, it's over.
One of the other things that, you know, I know y'all saw, and I guess we can kind of clump them together because a lot of them were saying the same shit, but like a lot of these younger rappers, you know, these mumble rappers who basically was kind of shitting on the 90s, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, not really feeling like they need to know anything about a Tupac or a Biggie or like Vince Staples, even though I think he said this last year, saying that the 90s were overrated because it didn't have
Vince Staples in it.
But I thought, you know, I thought that was a testament to, you know, that whole generation and how they think based off of social media, basically giving them the pass to think, you know, they've already made it when they ain't made shit, to be honest.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, it's,
he got into it with one of them over there, right?
Huh?
Pete Rock got into it with one of them over there.
Yeah, Pete was on Twitter. Yeah.
I forgot one of them little niggas, little Yaki, little Baki, one of the little niggas over like some disrespectful thing that he said. And I think somebody said like, what's a Pete Rock, or was that a Supremo, who cares, or whatever. Like, yeah, these youngins, man, they bugging, man. They bugging, man. Well, what else, man? You keep us updated. So any other bad stuff? Tell me this, because I have some questions. Let me ask you this. So Troy Ave, the shooting at Irving Plaza, and then I see last week or 2 days ago he got shot up in Brooklyn.
Yeah,
what's wrong with the Troy Ave nigga? He's from Brooklyn. What's Troy Ave's even with that nigga? Like somebody killed himself, and then he said some ill shit about
Joey
Badass's man or something like that. But what's Troy Ave's? What's his whole thing for this year?
Yeah, Capital C.
I think it's a lot of Brooklyn beef, to be honest, because everybody you just named, Joey Badass, Troy Ave, that shooting, the rumor is it had a lot to do with Tax Stone, who's also from Brooklyn. It's all that shit is some Brooklyn shit. And, you know, Troy Ave, and I'm only going off of, you know, Twitter stuff and probably records, but he has this arrogance about him that you know, I don't know if it's warranted streetwise. I mean the video, you know, he did take the gun from dude and come out busting, which was stupid, but at the same time, you know, this dude gotta decide, man. He honestly, if he want to pursue a career and live a different life, he need to leave BK, because it's too much street shit that surrounds his career at this point. And obviously, whoever shot him up, yo, they were trying to kill him. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, shit, they were trying to kill him in the club. And just wanted to kill his man. So, yeah, man, Troy Ave. And I kind of like Troy Ave. You know, I know a lot of dudes, the internet hates that nigga. Like,
I think it was because of the arrogance, like you said.
Yeah. But yeah, that dude just needs to decide on whether he just want to be in the street or he gonna do some rap shit, because you know, I know some dudes want you to put in dirt so they feel like your music is better, but fuck that. Like, you
know, now tell me this, because I thought, so somebody got killed with the Urban Plaza joint. Wasn't he supposed to be locked up or something?
Yeah, he was for a minute, but they didn't really, well, they had shit on him. They had him shooting in the club, but who knows? I know he got out on bail. I don't know what else is left, but it was his man who served as a bodyguard. Yeah, he got shot. Because
I mean, I know y'all send, y'all New York niggas don't play. Y'all send Odell Beckham. I mean, not Odell Beckham. Who's the other nigga from the Giants who shot himself?
Oh, talking about the dude to play for Plesko. Yeah.
I know y'all got some crazy gun laws in New York, so I would think the niggas not just for having a gun, let alone you busting off and killing people, but,
yeah,
you know, I can't call it. Yo, what did y'all think? What you say, man?
I said, Plaxico, he shot himself and then you got locked up for shooting yourself.
Yeah. That's why I'm looking like Troy out. I'm like, he got shot. Ain't this nigga in jail? Like, yo, he killed somebody. Like, yo, I need rap lawyers, man. They be getting niggas off for some heavy shit, man. But what do y'all think about the whole Joe Budden dissing Meek Mills? Or is that just tired? I mean, dissing Drake.
It's a lose-lose situation. Cause Drake is like Teflon. You can't nothing. That was gonna be my bad. Like, the bad of the year is the fact that Drake is the top rapper. I cannot get over that ever. That wheelchair Jimmy. when we that cat went, man, he wouldn't put out a record. They're like, you an actor for real.
Yeah.
You're gonna come in here, you got a silver spoon from both sides of the fence, the Jewish side and the black side. I had money. Cred, right. No struggle with you, the top cat in the rap.
Yeah.
I don't even hate Drake, but this, the Views album, that was not good.
Yeah, it wasn't.
Yeah.
It went.
And I like Drake. I've been a fan of stuff, but this Views album was just not really. Production wise, I don't know what happened with 40 or none of that stuff. It just wasn't. Yeah. I think it was maybe like one or two songs that were okay, exactly. But you know, again, it may just be like Vague said earlier, like the last mixtape he put out with Legend and those joints. Maybe that was the banger, and then the album, you know, just isn't that, and we just need to look forward to the mixtapes or whatever. Yo, what did y'all think about the whole J. Cole? Did you feel like he was dissing Ye and Wale, or he was just trying to get in their ear? But then my thing is like, nigga, call me if you want to get my ear. Like, Vague, if you got a problem with me, you ain't got to make a song about me. You can call me. You know what I mean? How did y'all feel about J. Cole and that whole false prophet joint? Vague, what'd you think about the false prophet joint?
I thought it was cool, but I think the fucking album put that fire out quick, because it made me forget, you know what I'm saying? I was hyped when I heard that shit. And, you know, not that I needed him to get all hippity-hop and shit and just be bars king on his album, but like you said, you know, you get us ready, and then you give us this boring ass, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's like if you walk in somebody's house and it smells good as shit, and then they put a fucking ravioli that came out of a can on the plate, like, yo, here you go. Like, nigga, this is what you were cooking?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But I think he was, I don't know, some of that shit he was saying I would take as a diss. But he was kind of trying to do what Kendrick did with Control, but less harsh, you know what I'm saying? Which I still don't get over the fact that Kendrick referred to that nigga as Jermaine when he was naming people. Like, ain't that your homie? Shit. But yeah, I thought it was cool. I didn't think it was a big deal. I thought the timing was a little bit off, because something's obviously wrong with Kanye mentally.
Oh yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I guess Jay was like, fuck it, put that shit out. Like, you know, this nigga went diss me at concerts, put that shit out with the video. But yeah, it was all right, but the album made me forget about it.
Yeah, exactly. It did. Yeah. I felt like, you know, Wale kind of was in on that because Wale came out too quick behind it. Like, and then they had the basketball game doing the FaceTime. I'm like, come on, man.
Right. Now, I know what you're saying because I thought the same thing because I'm like, damn, y'all some quick-ass writers. Like, I ain't no MC. You know, but I'm like, yo, y'all be coming back with a diss record. Like, he put it out at 8 o'clock. You got your right. dropping at 10 o'clock. Like, yeah. Damn, y'all some quick writers, man.
And the Wale joint was hot.
Yeah, but see, Wale, but you see, he went to Jake One for that shit. But that's not the shit that's going to be on
the album, exactly.
Okay. Album. Yeah. Now, I'm sure Jake One may get a beat. But it don't, you know, it won't be, you know, and I love the joint that Jake did with Wale, with him and Usher. That's one of my favorite Jake One beats. But, you know, yeah, and then it's crazy just the whole Kid Cudi thing going to rehab for depression and now yay with this, you know, paranoia and hallucinations and everything else, man. So I don't know if the game is killing us or what. And it's almost real quick what Rack was talking about a little bit earlier on the other episode about Rhapsody getting signed to Roc Nation and the Locks getting signed to Roc Nation. I said it before, man. I feel like this is just Jay-Z just pulling the wool over our eyes again, just trying to find another way to get us hip hoppers and us backpackers to fall back in love with him. Like, oh, look, now you're going to sign Rhapsody and the Locks and now they're going to blow up. And nah,
it's not. They're not blowing up, that's for sure.
I'm just happy they put something out. Because
yeah, no, I am glad about that. Like, Rap was like, yo, Rhapsody don't blow now. She ain't never going to blow. And I'm like, bro, don't hold your breath because.
Yeah.
I feel like Jay does stuff like that. Like, yeah, it's a tax write-off. Like, we signed Rhapsody. All the hip-hop people love us again. We signed the Locks. They love us. You know, just keep it moving. But I don't think Jay, to be honest with you, I don't know how you blow Rhapsody up right now. You know, I felt like she was doing wonders with Knife Wonder. So, you know, yeah. I understand, you know, of course, it's Jay-Z, so you got to, you know, go a step up. But I just don't see anything that he can do for her outside of, what did he do for Memphis that time? Like that, he put a song on Memphis's album. So if you want
to play the opening song, yeah, the first song
was Memphis album. So I don't see him getting her better production, or I mean, unless he's gonna get her some coke deals or some endorsements or something like that. I don't see what he can do to make her any doper than what she already is to get her to blow. And then the last thing for me was just this was a fucked up year for deaths, man. We just lost too many. I'm just Prince, David Bowie, George Michaels. The one that really hurt me, of course, Prince, but Sharon Jones. I'm such a big Sharon Jones and the Dab King.
Jones and the Dab King.
Just battling cancer. And, you know, we lost Fife, Morris White, Vanity, Billy Paul, you know, Afeni Shakur. And then just even off the music, just Muhammad Ali, Bill Nunn, Radio Raheem, that was my nigga, and then Tommy Ford, Martin. This was a rough year, man. You know, I felt like 2016 was like a bad episode of Final Destination, man. Like, every other day, it was like, yo, I get on Twitter, I see somebody name in the corner trending, I'm like, oh, man, what the, you know, who died now? Like, I don't even want to see your name trending, because that's what the first thing that comes to people's mind now when they see your name trending. Like, so, that's just
passed away.
But yo, Ray, give them all your stuff, the podcast, everything. This is where I got to go to keep up. So cats need to go to Veg and tune in and subscribe and all that good stuff to his joint because he keeps you updated with everything. So what's all your stuff, Veg?
Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter at VegasWorldINC or Instagram. The name of the podcast is Hip Hop Now Podcast. It's available on everything from iTunes to Google Play. But the hub is soundcloud.com/hiphoppolitic. I'm also, I've been testing the waters, but in 2017, I'm gonna do some video reviews because I used to do them back in the MySpace days.
You did one a minute ago in the whip, right? You was reviewing something in the whip, right?
Yeah, I did. What was that? Yeah, I did something recently, but I'm gonna do them more consistently, and you know, combine some things. Like tonight I'm putting out my top five hip-hop albums and mixtapes of 2016, but I got a video version, I got an audio version, and then I got the blog for you niggas who still read. But yeah, man, Hip-Hop Now Podcast, check it out.
All right, no doubt. Nick, what's all your stuff?
Yeah, Twitter is only one way to win. So it's only the number one way, the number two last name, WYNN, Instagram, 14 karat gold, slum computer wizard, no vibes.
I'm confused as shit. What's your Instagram?
When Ghostface came in, you don't remember when Ghostface came in, the 14 karat gold slum computer wizard?
Yeah.
No vibes.
How about this, my dude? Follow me. We just gonna do that. I didn't even know you was on IG, so just do that, and then I'm good money because I'm confused. Y'all can see all these rappers. I'm confused. You got no vowels. I don't know if that no vowels or this. That's part of the title. I'm confused. Vegas talking about reading. One of the things I want to put out. You know, if YouTube guys are interested, to all the viewers, I want to do a book list. I used to read all the time. I read like maybe four books in 2016, which was to read 12 to 24 books a year, you know, back in the day. I want to get back on it. One book a month. We're going to do a podcast at the end of each month to talk about the book. If y'all in for it, we're going with Jay Williams from Duke, who I hate. But I wanted to hear his story about him surviving a motorcycle accident, reinventing himself. Forgot the name of the book just that quick. But if cats are interested, get at me on Twitter, at Kill889. We'll make beats for food. Want to try to get that popping. You know, like Vegas said, for the cats who still read, we got to get some reading going on. I go to people's cribs. I have never been to anybody's house and seen a fucking bookcase. I haven't. I just haven't. I seriously haven't. I've been to people's houses. I've seen 80-inch TVs. I've seen 5-car garages. I've seen BMWs. Yeah. I've not seen bookcases. I'm the last house in the world that has bookcases.
Bookcase.
We got to start reading again, y'all. So get at me if y'all trying to get down with it. As always, Vegas, thank you for schooling us on 2016, because I forgot about all that shit you just said. I forgot it even happened. I had a whole list of things. I didn't have none of this stuff that you had.
Yeah.
So thank you. Nick, as always, appreciate you, bro. I'll check y'all next week.
All right.